Welcome, friends, wherever you are and whatever time it is, welcome to this time of worship with Peninsula United Church here in South Surrey in White Rock. I want to make a special welcome to folks from Pitt Meadows United Church who are joining us this week while your minister, Reverend Bethan, is on vacation. We will be celebrating communion in our worship today, so we invite you to get some bread and juice for worship. And I'd also invite you to get a candle in your worship space. This beautiful and bountiful place where we live, work, play, and worship is the traditional territory of the Coast Salish peoples. We give thanks for the careful stewardship of the lands and waters offered by the Semiamu First Nation for thousands of years. And we pray that we may live together in the spirit of reconciliation, respect, and friendship. Only one announcement to make this week, and that is to please join us for our Zoom coffee time after our worship on Sunday at 11 o'clock, and look to your Friday email for the link to the Zoom. We look forward to seeing you there. We're starting a new worship series today that we pray will bring a breather and a sense of assurance to us all. Life is a series of exclamations from, oh no, to help, to oh yeah. And we can swing between disappointment, helplessness, and gratitude on a daily, sometimes even an hourly basis. The Book of Psalms knows all about this. Written over a span of time from exile and isolation to the rebuilding of the community, the poetry of the Psalms will accompany us in this series, reminding us that through it all, we can trust that God is indeed holding our lives. The central anchor image for the next 6 weeks is cupped hands. And you might want to do what we've done here. In the Friday email, you'll find a download for a simple line drawing of cupped hands. You can print a copy and place it in a bowl, just as we've done here, and let it become a prayer focus, a prayer bowl for yourselves, adding names of people and situations that you are offering to God throughout the week. You might also want to remember to bring some paper to your worship space as well. And I just request if anyone has ceramic or clay hands that we could borrow to have on our communion table for our worship videos, please let me know. Let's join in worship now as we seek to simplify and slow down for a time. Let us lean on prayer, reflection, and sharing with one another. Let's light our candles now as a reminder of Jesus, who we know as the light of the world. The light which shines in the darkness, which the darkness cannot overcome. We do not live in a land ruled by kings, as the hearers of our first psalm of this series did. Nevertheless, the petitions of the psalmist for justice, deliverance, defense of the poor and oppressed, and peace for all peoples is an undergirding theme of our faith. We are reminded that a just society is one that proclaims these lives are precious and worthy of protection. God indeed is holding our lives. Let this be our epiphany in this new year.
Lift up your eyes, behold the hills, from where will help and rescue come. We call on one who made the earth, who blessed the stars, sun. God is holding your life. God is holding your life. God is holding your life. We believe. God is holding your life. Yes, God is holding your life. God is holding your life.
Please pray with me. Holy and just God, you have shown us what is right and good. Open us this day to a vision of the world made all right, so that we might follow your ways and know the peace of your reign on earth as it is in heaven.
We praise you for your steadfast presence, holding our lives together in love. Amen.
Thank you. The scripture reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 72, verses 1 to 7 and 10 to 14. It's taken from the Lucan Psalter translation. O God, give your anointed one your judgment and your justice. Teach your chosen one to govern your people rightly and bring justice to the oppressed. The mountains will bring the people peace, and the little hills bring justice. Your anointed will defend the oppressed among the people, save the children of the poor, and crush the oppressor. The reign of your anointed will endure as long as the sun and the moon, throughout all generations. The rule of the chosen one will be like rain coming down on the meadow, like showers watering the earth. Justice will flower through the days, an abundance of peace till the moon shall be no more. Tarshish and the isles will offer gifts. Arabia and Sheba will bring tribute. All rulers will pay homage, and all the nations will serve your anointed. Your anointed will rescue the poor when they cry out, and the oppressed when there is no one to help them. Your chosen one will take pity on the lowly and the poor and will save their lives. Your chosen one will rescue them all from violence and oppression, and will treat their blood as precious. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
In this series, we have a guest composer, Richard Broxfort Culligan, who is a modern-day interpreter of the Psalms. He is a psalmist. As you heard in the threshold song that Richard wrote, God is Holding Your Life, his songs have easy to sing choruses that help bring the seminal message into our voices and our hearts. We're going to learn another of Richard's songs based on our psalm for today. The chorus is, "These lives are precious, these lives are precious, we know." You'll catch on quick. But first, let's hear from Richard himself about this psalm and how he interprets it in his song.
Hi, friends. It's Richard. I want to invite you into a song for Psalm 72. Psalm 72 is an interesting one. It seems like back in the day, this song was written as a coronation hymn, a blessing for a king. The leader that they are singing about, that they're asking God to bless, was a remarkable person. Listen to this. This king was compassionate and generous and always looking for justice for his people. This person paid attention to the poor, it says, the lowly, those living with violence. This king paid attention to the most vulnerable in society. Psalm 72 invites us to think about who is most vulnerable in our society right now, in the world, in your neighborhood, in your circle of friends, or in your family. Who is most vulnerable? And what would it be like to be as compassionate and generous as this king? The text says, "You are like rain showering down on the farmland, so that up in the mountains where the fields grow, food will come up. That food is justice for everyone." This song is called "These Lives Are Precious," and it comes from a line, where is it here, that says, "The king redeems their lives from oppression and violence. Their blood is precious in his eyes." The most vulnerable of us, we can say, "These lives are precious." You're the goodness raining on the farmland. Your peace sprouting in the mountain fields. You're a harvest of the love and justice, ripening to feed and heal. These lives are precious. These lives are precious, you know. These lives are precious. All these lives are precious, you know.
The central theme for this new worship series is God is holding your life. This is a profound message that is deeply embedded in the ancient hymn book we call the Psalms. And we believe it's incredibly timely and relevant for our time, especially in the midst of a global pandemic. And even more so, perhaps, as we observe the events in Washington, D.C. this week, where the deep divisions in our society are illustrated with disturbing and graphic detail. Perhaps more than ever, we need to be assured that we are held firmly in the hands of love and grace. So it's a very special blessing today for us to hear from one of the members of our faith community, Larry Todd. And Larry's going to share with us some of his own experiences of being held by God. Larry joined our congregation a few years ago when he moved into the area, and since then he's been quite involved with various ministries, including helping with our soup Sundays and the community dinners, and being part of the team of pastoral care visitors that connect with the older members of our congregation. As we begin this new series, we're inviting folks to share their experience of being held, especially in times of challenge and hardship. So, Larry, when you consider the image of being held by God, what comes to mind for you?
The most important thing for me is that when I review and seriously examine the life journey that I've been on so far, there's always been a consistency when I choose to experience and to be received by a real God. Because in allowing myself to truly be open to the acceptance that I am no longer in control, and that I need something more than what either I've been doing or that others can do, that there's something more that will facilitate a betterness. And a wholeness, and within all of that, joy, peace, comfort, hope, and a better sense of wellness. So, for happenings in my life, many of my own choice, but certainly others involving circumstances way beyond my control, I have always, at the end of the day, simply said to God, first and foremost, I'm truly, truly sorry, or I can't deal with this, or I'm not knowing where to go. And in doing so, I asking for your help. And either forgive me first, or grant to me a wisdom or an understanding or a strength, quite often courage, because of fear. That has always been a big part of my life, whether from personal inadequacy, lack of knowledge, sense of incompetence, or just the inability to be better or be as good as somebody else.
So I think there's lots of times when we all feel that sense of inadequacy in ourselves. And what has been the result for you as you've asked God for help in those situations?
Well, I've found over the years that it's become easier to do so. And in finding it easier, I've become more humble in spirit. And humble for me is to feel the reality that it's okay not to be anything other than who you are. And being who you are doesn't mean that you have to be something more than what people might expect, or that you don't have to be as good as what might be needed, but what you are contributing is what is needed, because that's who you are as the individual that God intends. I've found over the years that a real strong belief in knowing that I myself have been given life, as every other individual person has, but because I've been given that life has value. And meaning and purpose, and that it's up to me through a developing relationship with my trust in God and acceptance of God being the way, the truth, the life for me, I can continue to be open to being received, being held, being loved, but most of all, just being a person that is meant to be a part of whatever it is in the journey that I've been given here.
So as you've taken time to ask God for that help, forgiveness, you've developed an openness to knowing that you are enough and that you are being held by God.
Ideally, that's what I would like to have happen all the time.
Right.
But my journey is continuing to come somewhat closer to that. Some days are better than others.
Right.
Like for today, here I am sitting here in the sanctuary with my jeans on and my plaid shirt. And I've done that deliberately, not to be a redneck, but because God doesn't really care about what's on the outside here. It's really what's coming from my heart and my faith and my openness and trust that whatever it is I'm doing here will be in accordance with how it is that God can use the presentation of myself for whoever is going to be hearing this or listening to this. And I have no idea what it is, but hopefully I will resonate with the spirit present to do God's will. And for me, that's completeness.
Wonderful.
That's wholeness. What I can do and you can do is to encourage each of us to continue to believe the one sure, certain factor always is that God is present. God has made a commitment to love us, to receive us, to be with us, and always to renew us and transform us, uplift us, guide us, and enable us to live the fullest life possible for who we are in God's creation.
I wonder if there's a particular time in your life that you really had a strong sense of God holding you that you might want to talk about today.
I guess I'll pick the most recent one. In moving here from Manitoba, the basis was through a separation, which was, first of all, totally unexpected. And coming here to BC to be with my two sons. I've come here in the past, maybe once every 2 years or so, and that's as much as I've had contact with the area. So to come here was a total new beginning. And I had always wanted throughout my life to somehow have what I call a magical congregation. And to me, a magical congregation is one where there's amazing potential in the congregation with the people involved. First of all, their gifts and their experience and their willingness to really do the best that they can in the service of God for the church. And another part of the wonder of a tremendous congregation, I always felt anyway, that the congregation is not only willing and wanting to maintain and to utilize the resources for the development of the persons in the congregation for their spiritual journey, but to be available and open to serve the ones in the community to the best of their ability, and also to support the needs of others worldwide through the mission and service. And whoa, I hit the jackpot when I came here because it's just incredible. And of course, with the amalgamation of your three churches and the financial base that is there, there's just all kinds of things that we can still be doing, and I hope you'll do. And I would never have guessed in my life that it could have happened. And lo and behold, it's here. And I really felt welcomed, held, supported, cared for. And it's God in you and all the other people here and what's happening that has made it possible. And the other reality of God showing love and presence is, of course, the continuity now that I have with my own family and my grandchildren. So life is starting to be good, really good. And to make a connection again, hopefully with that special person in life, that's starting to evolve, I think. No guarantee, but anyway, like all of those things are manifestations of the reality of God's presence in the world. He still hasn't made sure I've won lottery tickets. That's been going on for decades. Believe me, that's not a critical thing.
How wonderful for us to hear that you have been blessed by being part of our community of faith, because I know that we have certainly been blessed by your presence and activity within our community. So thank you for sharing this and for sharing your experience with us today.
Okay, thank you.
In the psalm that Larry read for us, Psalm 72, and that Richard has helped us to sing, we hear the words that might have been spoken at the coronation of kings. As our psalmist composer Richard points out, these words picture a ruler who is truly extraordinary in their care and compassion for the people. I doubt that any ruler, ancient or modern, has been able to live up to that vision. But holding up that vision is so important. It's both ironic and evocative to reflect on these words in the midst of this time when so many of our own political leaders have struggled with the price and requirements of leadership, and how hard it can be to lead with justice and compassion, especially for the most vulnerable. I'm sure many of us were appalled to discover how many political leaders flaunted the health orders and travel restrictions and went away to enjoy their Christmas holidays. And I heard just this morning that there are many Canadians who are still traveling to resorts in Mexico and elsewhere. It's not easy for us to lay down our privileges for the sake of others. But our psalm reminds us that building justice with the oppressed and celebrating the preciousness of all people is like the rain and the sun that feeds and nurtures our gardens and farms, our forests and our oceans. Some of our leaders have lost sight of how precious each life is, or sadly, they may never have discovered it. But in a time and in a society when we don't have supreme rulers anymore, this ancient call to be a ruler that cares for the poor and rescues the oppressed, that falls on each one of us.
We all share this responsibility and this amazing opportunity to hold each life and recognize how precious they are. And that call falls especially on those of us who enjoy much greater privilege than others. As we share and celebrate how God is firmly holding each one of us in love, the question then is, how will we live and embody that holding for others in this coming year? Wherever there are necks stepped on, as it says in the psalm, whether physically or economically or socially, the whole society suffers. We certainly pray for the kind of rule in our world that honors each precious life. And we are each called, and we are called together as a community, to build a world in which the most oppressed among us are valued fully and experience being deeply held in love.
The Psalms have a repeated direction throughout, the word Selah. Scholars are not sure exactly what it means. Perhaps because the Psalms were to be used in worship, we can surmise that the word indicates a pause or perhaps an invitation for a musical instrument to be played. In this worship series, we will use an instrumental sound to remind us to take a pause, a breath, and remember that the settling of our hearts can offer the feeling that we are held in the hands of the divine. We'll hear the sound of a bell, and then we'll have some silence. I invite you to close your eyes if you like, or focus on your candle. Imagine yourself held in the safety and love and care of the Holy One. And when you hear the sound again, open your eyes. Each week, we will have a moment to write prayer concerns on small pieces of paper, and then we'll place these prayers in a container, your prayer bowl, as a symbolic action of placing them in God's hands and in God's care. So take a moment to do this, and I'll place my prayer concern for the people of the United States. Let the people say, Selah.
Selah.
Selah. Let us continue our prayers. I'll offer a category of concern, and we will allow a brief pause, and then I'll offer a name for God, for example, God of Justice, and I ask you to respond, hear our prayer. So as a prayer posture for this worship series, I invite you to cup your hands, ready to receive God's love and peace, and in preparation to be God's love and peace in the world. Let us pray for the leaders of this world and this church community. God of Justice,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who live in conflict around the world. Prince of Peace,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all who are experiencing loss of any kind in this pandemic. Comforting healer,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those who are homeless, hungry, and alone. Emmanuel, God with us,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for ourselves and others who live in comfort, that we would offer Christ-like hospitality, compassion, and generosity. Transforming Spirit, hear our prayer. Holy and Living One, as we gather to break bread once again, break us open to your love, to your peace, to your presence, to your transformative power. In the name of the one who invites us time and again, Jesus the Christ, let the people say, Salah.
Salah.
We are all invited to the gift of this table of grace. As a response to the invitation, we are asked to let go of all that separates us from accepting this grace. And so we confess the ways we have placed hardship in the hands of others rather than peace. Place peace in each other's hands, we place love in all the hands of the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Will you make a gesture of extending your cupped hands towards others who may be with you as you worship, as a sign of offering the peace that Christ gives us? And if you are alone, place your cupped hands over your heart, as a sign that you send your heartfelt peace out to the world.
Give thanks for strong yet tender hands held out in trust and blessing, where words fall short, let hands speak out the hearts of love expressing.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Open your hearts, your mouths, your lives to the Holy One.
We long for this communion.
Let us give our greatest thanks in the company of the Beloved.
It is a good and joyful thing to give our thanks and praise.
Gift of life, creator of all that is, you have breathed life into us, filled our emptiness, loved us through our resistance. Time and again, you say, listen. Time and again, you say, live. Time and again, you say, love. And so we gather and give thanks in this moment. We stop so we may listen. We breathe so we may live. We open so we may love. Are you God, and blessed be your work in Jesus, peace giver, life healer, spirit anointer. Do your work in us as in him.
May we proclaim release, recovery,
liberty, and the end of all oppression. May we savor the taste of goodness and offer this gift of love to all. Jesus gathered with his disciples, his friends, his family. He took bread, said thanks over it, gave it to his companions and said, "Take, eat, this is my body. My life is given for love of you." So wherever you gather together, stop, salah, think of me. Be at peace. I am here. And after the supper, he lifted his cup, gave thanks over it, and offered it to his companions, saying, "Drink from this cup, all of you. This is my life, my love poured out for you. Whenever you gather together, stop, salah, think of me, be at peace. I am here."
Put peace into each
acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Holy Spirit, breath of wind, fill us, transform us. Holy Spirit, lover of justice, fill us. transform us. Holy Spirit, maker of unity, fill us, transform us. And all God's people say, Amen.
As at communion, shape your hands into a waiting cradle. The gift of Christ receive, revere, united round the table.
Let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We who are many are one body, one loaf, rising in spirit together. Even if we cannot be physically in the same space, we are one in love. We are one in the grace of Christ, broken open for us. And while we have many cups, God's love is poured upon us from the one cup of salvation. It is in this sharing beyond all time and space that we are drawn close, that we are made whole, that we are made free. If you are with others, we invite you to serve one another. If you're by yourself, know that the hand that serves you is the hand of all of Christ's body. Through mystical union with the divine, you are not alone. Receive the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation. Let us pray. O God of all that is too deep for words, we give you thanks that at this table of grace you offer your holiness and your steadfast love. Open us often to your salah, your pause, to hear the needs of your people and respond in love as we are able. We pray this in the name of the host of this table, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let's join in singing our final hymn, We Shall Go Out with Hope of Resurrection.
Now go out in the knowledge that God is holding your life, even as we hold each other. You are not alone. You are loved. Amen.